This is my next generation Sensorbox for monitoring 3D printer emissions and general air quality in your home. You can kit it out with sensors for particles, VOCs, formaldehyde, carbon monoxide and dioxide. And this one I've optimized to be as easy as possible to build and to use the cheapest possible parts that still give you good measurements and help you quantify how safe or unhealthy your environment is. And the best part is, the button I put on top has the most satisfying click ever. This dims the screen if you want to put it in your bedroom, but everything about this is totally customizable. This is simply a better version of the box I used in my video measuring printer emissions, and for this video I'll show you every step for how to build one yourself, and also how the software works that runs this box, and how it then logs all of that data for you to dig through, or to automate alerts, or turn on ventilation units and air filters based on thresholds you set. Spoiler, it's Home Assistant, which makes everything super easy. And to build this Sensorbox, I'm using a custom PCB from today's sponsor, JLC PCB. I love designing PCBs. For me, they make electronics projects a whole lot easier, and the final product feels so much more finished and professional versus chucking up a breadboard or soldering up a proto PCB. I considered doing a tutorial for building this Sensorbox for both this new version with the PCB and for the old version with jumper cables as well. But ordering 5 of these PCBs with shipping costs less than $5 from JLC PCB, so there's literally no reason not to build a nicer version using a PCB. This is a simple 2-layer PCB, but JLC PCB right now also has a special offer for 6-layer PCBs with free tinting for via and pad to optimize your routing efficiency and electrical performance. JLC PCB checks all 6-layer PCBs with a full 4-wire test, and you can get your own designs or the one for this project made within 48 hours, starting at just $2 plus shipping. Thanks again to JLC PCB. Check them out at the link below. So first of all, this project is based on an ESP32 microcontroller. And instead of using pure Arduino code to talk to each of the components and to analyze the data, I'm using the ESP Home framework. ESP Home comes with drivers for tons of sensors, inputs, outputs, and makes it super simple to then do something useful with the data, be it just displaying it on a screen or controlling something like a relay output based on sensor thresholds on the same chip. But ESP Home is also part of the Home Assistant project, so it's really well integrated into that as well. Home Assistant is basically a self-hosted smart home hub that can connect with many of these smart devices in your home, and then lets you monitor and control them through the same interface, no matter what manufacturer or interface they use. So, for example, you could have a Hue bulb flash red when the air quality sensor detects unsafe particle levels in your printer room, but only when you're home. When you're not home, you can have a Zigbee smoke detector send you an alert on your phone. I also have it controlling my basement dehumidifiers with a simple smart plug so that they only turn on when my SMA solar inverters report there is enough solar power available. It's really awesome. Also, Home Assistant automatically logs all the data it receives, and it can view that with graphs and statistics. It's just a super neat system, and it doesn't lock you into yet another proprietary cloud service. So whether or not you're building the Sensorbox, if you have any sort of smart devices, I would absolutely recommend installing Home Assistant and just playing around with it. Just grab a spare Raspberry Pi or set it up in a VM on your NAS. Mine runs in a VM on Unraid. Also, for this project, I found it's overall the best way to set up and manage the Sensorbox with the ESP Home add-on right inside Home Assistant. There are plenty of excellent tutorials on getting started with Home Assistant, so I'm not going to go into details here, but in any case, make sure you do get the full Home Assistant OS. If you just run it in a Docker container, you don't quite get the full functionality. I'm going to link a couple good tutorials in the description below. Once the basic Home Assistant setup is done, you can grab the ESP Home add-on inside Home Assistant, link below as well. And we're ready to get to the Sensorbox hardware itself. For this, you will need the printed parts for the case, the main PCB, the main components, like the ESP, a display, a DC-DC converter, a button, headers, a couple of screws. And of course, you will want, you know, the set of sensors that you want to use. Let's start with the printed parts. you'll end up with a controller pack that is fully built and functional, and that then simply slides into the outer shell. This design made everything easy to assemble and easy to print. The shell gets printed upside down, it doesn't need any support material, and you can print it from any material and color you'd like. The other parts are the spacers for the screen and the shelf for mounting the wired sensors, and both of those are also simple prints that any printer should be able to handle. Next, the main PCB. Ordering these online is super simple. You just upload a zip file with the design, select the lead-free option, and with the cheapest shipping, for less than $5, you'll have 5 of these PCBs in your hands in just about 2 weeks' time, which is how long the rest of the parts will take as well if you order them from AliExpress. You don't have to fully populate all the sensors, so you can use the rest of the boards for simpler setups that just monitor basic air quality. More on that in a second. Then the basic components for the electronics build. The video description will have a full list in there with all the details, but in short, you will need an ESP32S2, these are usually about $2, a simple DC-DC converter to support the 3.3 volt supply, a standard button, a couple pin headers and sockets, a few screws, and an LCD screen. The standard 2.8 inch LCD screen is cheap and pretty large, though it doesn't have the greatest viewing angles. I found it still the best compromise for now, and this is what the software is set up for out of the box. But the PCB also has headers for a smaller but surprisingly crisp 1.3 inch IPS screen and a 2.13 inch e-ink panel. So if you want to use one of those, the hardware fully supports them. And lastly, the sensors. There are sort of 4 different classes of sensors that we're using here. Temperature and humidity, which is just generally useful information, but also some of the other sensors need that info for reference. Then a CO2 specific sensor, which is super useful for knowing when your indoor air is used up from just living and breathing in there, but not useful at all for measuring 3D printer emissions. If your printer emits CO2, it's literally on fire, and I think a classic smoke detector would do a much better job at alerting you to that. Then a particle sensor, which is the largest and most expensive sensor, but also the one that gets you the most meaningful data for measuring FDM 3D printer emissions and for general air quality degradation from things like fires or combustion heaters. Lastly, the gas and VOC sensors, which I found to not be super necessary for FDM, but highly useful for resin printing. The PCB allows you to plug in a whole range of sensor boards. All these sensors work with ESP Home and are available as these cheap plug-and-play breakout boards. I've ordered all of mine from AliExpress. They tend to be the cheapest there with all the sales and discounts they've always got going on, but you can also find most of them on Amazon or Raspberry Pi and Arduino specialized shops. Some have subtle variations in the versions you can get. Again, the component list has the details on which ones to get. Here are the sensor loadouts I would recommend for the different applications. For FDM printing, get a basic AHT20 plus BMP280 board for temperature, humidity, and pressure data. Then add an SGP30 for overall VOC measurement, and finally a PMS503 for particle counts. For resin printing, again, AHT20 plus BMP280, then add the SGP30, but instead of a particle sensor, get the ZE08 formaldehyde-specific sensor. General VOC sensors have some sensitivity to formaldehyde, and the ZE08 will also show some response to other VOCs, but having the two different sensors will help you determine whether you've just got some ethanol fumes in the air, which standard VOC sensors are generally very sensitive to, or some more nasty stuff like formaldehyde, which the ZE08 will show more clearly. And lastly, the setup for general home air quality monitoring. AHT20 plus BMP280 and combined with something like an SGP30 will be a pretty decent approximate air quality indicator. If you live in an area with lots of wood-burning fireplaces or live near a busy road and want to keep an eye on pollution from that, particle counts are pretty relevant, so add a PMS503. And if you want a precise indicator of CO2 for indoor air, add the SCD40 CO2 sensor. You can mix and match these however you want. This is just what I found most effective for these applications. The PCB also has a couple of optional headers on the side for plugging more specialized sensors. There's a header for connecting a modified MQ7 carbon monoxide sensor, which can be useful for monitoring open fireplaces or gas furnaces, but isn't really useful for 3D printing. maybe for laser cutting. Then you can plug in an ENS160 VOC sensor, which is a low-cost sensor that doesn't always produce repeatable VOC measurements, so when I used it, I had two of them plus another type to verify. These usually come with another AHT20 temperature and humidity sensor on the same board, but the readings from that are not very useful because the ENS160 tends to heat up the entire board. But the ENS160 has one quite useful feature. It's very cheap, and it reports an approximate CO2 level based on its reading, similar to what the SGP30 does. That estimated level is, I mean, not always perfectly accurate, but surprisingly often it's close enough to the true CO2 levels that if you only need a rough good or bad indicator, it can certainly do the job for a fraction of the cost of what a real CO2 sensor like the SCD40 costs. And also, you can swap in an SGP41 instead of an SGP30. That's a different and newer sensor, but with ESP Home, the SGP41 only reports sort of a VOC index instead of an actual concentration in ppm. So for now, I would say the SGP30 is more useful. I've also put a spare header for the I2C bus onto the board, so if you want to modify the config and use your own sensors, like a combined SCN55, you can plug them in here. There's a header for addressable LEDs like the WS2812, and the spare GPIOs from the ESP32S2 are also broken out, so solder a pin header onto those and use them for whatever you can dream of. All right, enough talking, let's get to building. We should start out by flashing the ESP32S2. The easiest way to do that is to plug the ESP into a computer and then using a Chrome-based browser and the ESP Home web flasher. Get the ESP into the bootloader mode by holding the zero button when plugging it in, and then select the serial port to flash the basic ESP Home firmware. If it fails to connect, leave it plugged in, then hold the zero button again while briefly tapping the RST button, and finally let go of the zero button. Once the firmware is flashed, unplug and replug the ESP, connect one more time and use the web flasher to connect the ESP to your Wi-Fi. Now, if you head over to the ESP Home add-on in your Home Assistant setup, it will automatically find and show this new ESP. Click Adopt, then head up here into the Secrets menu and fill out your Wi-Fi name and password. Yes, I know, we just did that, but this is just extra insurance to make sure things go smoothly. Hit Save, then for the new ESP, edit the config and replace it with the sample config for the Sensorbox, and use the install button to flash it over Wi-Fi. This will take a minute or two, and if you ever want to make changes to the config, you can simply edit it here and reflash it the exact same way. Finally, to get the sensors to show up in Home Assistant, head over to the Home Assistant settings, and again, it should show up automatically as a new device. If not, head back to the ESP Home tab and open up the logs for your new ESP. Note the IP address it received, then head over to Settings, Devices and Integrations, Add Integration, ESP Home, and fill in the IP address of your new ESP. This will create a new device in Home Assistant that will hold all the sensor readings that the sensor box collects. All right, the rest of the build is easy, and that's the hardware. We've got all the firmware work out of the way up front, because once everything is assembled, the ESP is going to be a little bit inaccessible. So let's get the PCB assembled. There are two components that get soldered directly to the PCB, and the rest plugs into headers. Start with the push button up top. Make sure it sits flush all the way pushed against the PCB, and then add the DC-DC converter the right way around. There's a bit of a graphical layout help on the silkscreen. Then it's on to adding the headers for the sensors you're going to use. You can either populate just the ones you'll be using, or fill in everything for maximum flexibility. When you're soldering the headers for the ESP, it helps to plug in the ESP board into the headers to keep everything aligned. The headers on the left side for PMS, ZD08, addressable LEDs, and so on receive pins. All the others get sockets. Then install sockets for the display from the opposite side. There are also two spots for adding an electrolytic capacitor, one for 5V and one for 3.3 volts. If you end up having trouble with random reboots or instability, adding capacitors can often help in fixing those. Next up is soldering the pins to the sensor PCBs. These typically come unsoldered, and the PCB is laid out so that all of the carrier PCBs are oriented with the sensor element facing away from the main PCB. When you're soldering these, try to cover up the sensor element with something so that you don't get any flux splatter on them. The ZE08 formaldehyde sensor and the PMS503 particle sensor come with a ribbon cable, and my recommendation is crimping some simple DuPont style connectors to them, but if you don't care much for crimping, you can also just take the shortcut and solder the wires directly to the PCB, then add hot glue for strain relief. here is the pinout for hooking up the Z808 and for the PMS503. When you've plugged in all the sensor boards and the ESP, you can add the printed frames. You should be able to screw an M3 or a similarly sized screw directly into the screen space. Use a 25mm screw from the sensor side to sandwich the PCB between the rear shelf and the screen spacer, then mount the wired sensors you're using onto the shelf. That would be the Z808, PMS, or MQ7 if you want to use one of those. There's not a lot of spare height here, so try to get them pretty flush onto the spacer. Then, on the other side, plug in the screen, and the holes should line up just about perfectly. Finally, make sure you've got a USB-C cable plugged into the ESP to supply power, then carefully slide the assembled sensor block into the outer shell. Use M3x10 countersink screws, or whatever you have on hand, to fix the electronics unit in place in the outer shell. These will sandwich the screen between the outer shell and the printed screen spacer, and pull it tight towards the front. Finally, you can use a small zip tie for some strain relief on the USB cable, and with that, Sensorbox is complete. Some of the sensors take about a day of runtime to fully settle in and produce plausible readings, so just leave the Sensorbox plugged in for a bit. The screen on the Sensorbox itself will show the current readings of each sensor, but they're more useful inside Home Assistant. So just to get a feel for things, try this. Create a new dashboard and try adding a statistics diagram card for one of the sensors. Boom, graph. And for turning air cleaners on or off, of course, you'd also need something like a smart plug connected to Home Assistant. You can simply create a new automation that gets triggered every time your sensor readings change. And then as an action, check whether that sensor reading is above your threshold. And if yes, we turn on the smart plug. And otherwise, we turn it off. But that's really just the simplest possible way to make use of the data we're collecting. Home Assistant lets you do so much with it, and hopefully it'll help you stay aware and healthy around your machines. All the stuff you need to build one is linked below, and I want to give a huge shout out to everyone who's supporting the channel and allowing me to give all this stuff and all this info away for free. Thank you, and thank you to everyone who's watching. Keep on making, and I'll see you all in the next one. Bye.